WOLB Baltimore and WERQ FM HD3 Baltimore, celebrating Radio 1's 42nd anniversary.
Our Radio 1 family, our employees, their family members, our listeners, our viewers, our extended family.
And serving the African American community for over 42 years.
The views and opinions of the guest and host you hear on 1010 WOLB
are not necessarily those of the staff and management of Radio 1, its sponsors, or advertisers.
A boy's born in hot Mississippi, surrounded by for world that ain't so pretty. His parents give him love and affection to keep him strong, moving in the right direction, living just enough for the city. His father works some days for 14 hours, and you can bet he barely makes a dollar. His mother.
Hello, hello, hello. We're back for the second hour of the Frank M. Conaway Sr. et al. Show with co-host, attorney Tehma Smith Wilson.
Thank you, Baltimore, for joining us during the second hour. During the first hour, we had Mr. Jamaal Moses from the Baltimore County Department of Health and Human Services talk to us about mental health. So if you missed the first hour, go online and you'll be able to listen to it. I am Tehma Smith Wilson, an attorney and business owner based out of Baltimore City. The services we offer include real estate and estate planning. So if you need to buy or sell your property, update your will or your deed, or purchase your ground rent, give us a call at 667-334-7242. And if you would like to join the conversation and you're not able to get through on the phone lines, text your question or comment to 667-334-7242. And if you miss a broadcast, feel free to check us out on YouTube. All you have to do is go to YouTube, type in Frank Conaway Senior Show, and all of our past broadcasts will come up, and you can listen to us on your phone, your computer, or your television, and share it with others.
Okay, what's on your mind that you want to throw out there?
I received a few texts from our listeners. Everyone wants to talk about the verdicts.
Okay. All right, we're going to get to that because we know that's a hot topic. Robert Bob the Dean Dashiell.
Yeah, I want to talk about the decision that came out from a judge in the Eastern District of Tennessee, I think it was, and joining the SBA from continuing to implement a component of the 8A program, the small business program, where an individual of a certain race was presumed to be socially and economically disadvantaged. They've enjoined the use of that standard for the purpose of determining eligibility to participate in the program. Basically, what they've said is, as it relates to black people at least, so-called affirmative action doesn't exist anymore. And the irony of the foundation of that decision, not just which is a follow-up, a carry forward of the decision that came out of the Harvard case from the Supreme Court,
right,
a week or so ago. So I want to talk about that, the effect of it on MBE programs generally.
And you are expert on that.
And what it means to us as a people going forward.
Now, let me ask you something. This particular judge, was he a Trump appointee?
No.
No?
No. Okay. No. He was appointed by, I don't think it was Obama, but it was either appointed by Clinton. He was appointed by a Democratic president. It was not appointed by a Republican president.
Okay, fine. Your telephone number.
Oh, 410-547-8820. Leave a message because I hardly ever answer that number.
And Carlton C. Douglas here of the Carlton C. Douglas Funeral Service, PA. If you need our services, the telephone number to call is 410-669-1738, 410-669-1738. And as I said on the first hour, on next Friday, August the 4th, will be the viewing for Mrs. Nellie Young starting at 10 a.m. with the family time beginning at 11:30 and the service at 12:30 at the Pleasant Zion Baptist Church, 4317 North Point Boulevard. I am on my way to Atlanta tomorrow for our national convention. Oh, and by the way, some of you who read the Afro may have seen that on August the 6th, out at the Martin's Hunt Valley, there will be a tribute to we, and when I say we, I'm talking about the black funeral directors here in Baltimore City vicinity, for having come through the COVID situation the way we did. I am among some of the many who are being honored on that day. It's a ticketed affair. You need to call the Afro for, and ask for Diane Hocker if you're interested in being there. It's that Sunday, August the 6th at 1 o'clock at the Martin's Hunt Valley mansion out there. One of the things I want to get to, and I'm going to open up the lines because I know y'all want to talk about these verdicts today, as Tehma has brought up. But there's an interesting article in the USA Today titled "Extremism in Military Still Goes Unchecked. Sweeping crackdown and reforms after Capitol riot failed to materialize." And I think this is so true. I have been one of the ones that believe that not only has the military, but the police department, especially the good old FOP, been infiltrated with a whole host of white supremacists and right-wing extremists. I believe that one of the things that's going on with the pressure being on Lloyd Austin, who is the first African-American to be defense secretary for this country, is the fact that he's a black man. So if you have a USA Today paper, go out and get one and read that, because I think it's very relevant on what's going on in today's situation. You want to call in, Sandra, you can call back, all others, 410-481-1010, 410-481-1010. And Smitty, before we come to you, I want to start with Tehma about your opinion, and then I'm coming to Bob about both of y'all's opinion on these verdicts that just came out in the last day or so.
Just to give an overview, there were three verdicts that were released. One involved the squeegee kid mm-hmm. shooting. The other involved the young man who killed a pregnant lady and her child
6 years ago.
And the
mm-hmm.
third one involved the gentleman who killed I don't know if he was a student or not, but I know it happened on the Morgan campus or in that vicinity. So there were three different verdicts. I think the outcome for all three, I think they kind of play together. Because, I mean, I think the message that it sends is that Baltimore City is taking crime seriously, especially when it comes to murder. And if you do commit a murder, regardless of degree, you will be held accountable, whether it's first degree, second degree, or manslaughter. So I recognize that the squeegee kid probably got the most visibility. The jury came back with manslaughter versus a first or second degree murder. And I think the jury did an excellent job. I mean, that was a hard case. A lot of people thought maybe he should not be charged. A lot of people thought he should be charged. So I think the manslaughter verdict fell in the middle. And I think, you know, it was a tough case, but at the end of the day, he will be held accountable, but it's not first degree murder. So I think that the jury had a hard decision to make, and I think they did a good job for the jury to make that decision. The other two cases, I don't think there's any comment or any argument about what happened there. You know, I don't think anyone held up that it was self-defense or had any type of defense in terms of why they murdered or why that individual was murdered. So I think the outcome of them were well-deserved. That's my opinion.
I think what it demonstrates is that people, juries, are made up of people who arrive at their own sense of right and wrong. And to the extent, and somehow the evidence influences that or provides the factual predicate for that decision, But nevertheless, in the final analysis, they've reached a decision based upon what they think is right or wrong. I don't know how they reached a decision on manslaughter here. It was obviously a compromise, because there's no doubt in my mind that the shooting was intentional. And there's no doubt in my mind that self-defense doesn't apply when you're shooting somebody in the back, which, as I understand, part of the evidence was that this guy was shot three times in the back. So even though I believe that at some point in the, and that's the problem. See, we look at the situation as though it's a snapshot when it's really a motion picture. There were times during the altercation when the role of aggressor and so forth, they changed. There was times when the young man was the aggressor. There was time when the driver was the aggressor. So it's this question of, you know, the last that gets, it's like in sports. You know, the one the referee sees throw the last blow is the one who gets the penalty. Everything that happens before that sort of happens before that. So I don't see anything in these cases that's different from the outcomes in prior cases in Baltimore City. The notion that you can commit crime in Baltimore City and that Baltimore City jurors will not convict you is obviously not true. And a lot of people
absolutely
believe it's not true.
Yeah.
And a lot of people promote that, you know, and that Baltimore City will never convict somebody on a police officer's testimony is also not true.
Absolutely. Baltimore City residents convict people from Baltimore City every day.
Yes.
In court.
Yeah.
Every day.
Yeah.
My take on it is the same, except for I kind of thought he should. And by the way, we're going to try to get Jay Wendell on here maybe in the next week or so to talk about this case. But my feeling on the case was that he should have got second degree murder rather than the manslaughter.
I think that's valid as well.
That one of the things I had been waiting for, y'all heard me mention this on here, was the autopsy. The medical examiner testified, because it was being put out there that this guy was drunk, in other words, his alcohol level was supposed to have been off the chain, and that's why he went after these kids with the bat. Well, when the medical examiner testified, he testified that the guy had less than 0.03% of alcohol in his blood system, which means that he was not intoxicated. So that kind of blew that out the window. This thing that's going around, also, they're trying to say that he was not even on the scene or something like that, that the video was grainy, and that there was no fingerprint of his on the gun, but the fingerprint was on the bag of which the gun was in, was muddying some things. So I think it was a... Now, my concern, though, and I guess I have to ask you two, who are attorneys, and I don't know if you can really answer this or not, but now, okay, he's been convicted of manslaughter. Does the sentencing part now get thrown back into juvenile auspices, or does it stay the same where it is? And the other question I wonder about is, if this boy is going to be rehabilitated, or is he going to jail and wind up coming out in 3 or 4 or 5 years being taught how to be a worse criminal than what he was when he went in. What is your all's opinion on that one?
The first part is easy. He's going to be sentenced by the same judge who oversaw his trial. He was tried as an adult, and he's going to be sentenced by the same judge.
I guess my question then is he going to be sentenced as, because when this thing happened, he was 14.
Right.
So is he going to be sentenced as a juvenile, or is he going to be sentenced as an adult, because that's how it was found in adult court?
No, I think he's going to be sentenced as an adult. Now, his age will play a role in where he may be sent for incarceration. I don't know. How is he now?
He's 16 now.
Yeah, I suspect.
When it happened, he was 14.
Yeah, but I suspect he's going to be sentenced for a period of incarceration. It's going to be in an adult facility. I don't think he's going to be sent to a juvenile facility, because he was tried as an adult. But the more difficult question is, the question you raise about rehabilitation versus penalty. You see, because when the penalty speaks to the whole issue of accountability. That accountability has nothing to do with rehabilitation. And for, with respect to the interest you raised rehabilitation right after Dr. Moses' participation earlier, because the thing that he may need rehabilitation from was something that was done and occurred during their childhood, which may be very difficult to diagnose or even to treat. We got to separate, the things that people do in the, quote, heat of passion that they would not ordinarily do. There are things and there are things that people that affect some people passionately, emotionally, that don't affect you or some other people. It's not one size fits all. And unfortunately, you've got a system that's got to deal with thousands of these kind of cases and doesn't have the time or the expertise or the resources to really individualize the outcomes in most cases. So it is going to be interesting what happens here. And even your statement about the guy not being legally drunk, all that means is that he didn't meet the legal definition of intoxication. Doesn't mean he wasn't intoxicated, because we don't know what his personal tolerance was for alcohol. Some people can take one drink and they can't walk.
Right.
Some people
can
finish the bottle.
Yeah.
it's a very difficult question, and it'll be interesting to see how the judge comes out on the sentencing side. On the opportunity for the victims to speak, I think we've gone too far in that regard, to be honest with you, because the victim's impact statement. Okay, get that. We understand what the impact, but victims want retribution.
Yeah.
They don't want. And the criminal justice system is not just about retribution. It is also supposedly about rehabilitation.
And that's exactly what has thrown that Adnan Syed thing out of whack.
Yes, yes, exactly.
When I come to the phone, I'm coming to Smitty, Roger, Larry. We got two lines open, 410-481-1010. Tehma, 410-481-1010. Tehma.
I think these three trials has made the court system or the process kind of more transparent than what it has been in the past. You know, we know that the system is broken somewhere along the line, and our question to citizens was, where is it broken? What needs to be fixed? Okay, in these three cases, okay, we saw the police. Well, we saw a crime that was committed. The police did their job by catching the criminals, doing an investigation, coming to the court with evidence. The courts and the state's attorney did their job by prosecuting them, going through a legitimate trial, and coming out with verdicts that the citizens of Baltimore could kind of fall in line with. Now, the question is, in terms of punishment, what happens next? Does he get time or does he get rehabilitation? Why isn't there rehabilitation in both the juvenile and the adult system? That should not be an issue, because you're willing to rehabilitate juveniles, someone under, what, 18 or 21, but you're not willing to rehabilitate someone who's 25, who's charged as a criminal. That should be in both systems. It shouldn't be, well, you get help if you're a juvenile, but you don't get help if you're an adult.
Yeah.
When at the end of the day, both people are going to be released back to the streets.
Right. That's right.
You commit a crime as an adult.
Yeah.
Rehabilitation or not, you're still coming back on the street. So how is that going to solve the issue for the criminal or for the citizens in terms of making Baltimore a safer place?
And the question is, what does rehabilitation really mean? And in reality, all that it means is, what can we do with a person who's incarcerated to lessen the likelihood that they will come out and do it again?
Right.
That's all it means.
Right. But I mean, there should be some practices and some classes and some policies that you could point to saying, this is what we did while they were in jail, and this is the result that we hope that they have when they come out.
Other than the old time way of just making license plates,
right?
Well, I would tell you that's a false notion, because I don't know if you've ever been to Hagerstown. I assume you've never been incarcerated there.
But, no, I haven't. Thank God.
But
not that I know.
But when years ago, when Glenn Denning was governor, he had this council on privatization. The issue was what government functions to privatize and not. I happened to be the chairman of it, and during the course of that, we reviewed what was then the functions of what was then called the state use industries, which made the license plates. But what I found out is that the prisoners who made license plates did a lot more up at Hagerstown. They had a meat processing plant. Hmm. They had a furniture manufacturing plant.
Okay.
They had a clothing manufacturing plant. And there's a state law that requires all state agencies to buy what they need from that NASCAR Correctional Enterprises to buy everything they need that's produced there to buy it first from there on a priority basis. So with the interesting thing is that I found, of course, when I went there to visit, 99% of the inmates were black, 99% of the guards were white.
Right.
The question is, most of those inmates either had not, didn't have high school education or had no more than a high school education, but they were there operating and repairing intricate and delicate equipment.
Okay.
So
let
anyway,
me ask you this. Well, I'll go to the lines real quick.
Yeah.
Was the same thing being that was being done in Hagerstown, were the same things being done in Jessup and Upper Cumberland?
No.
Mm.
No.
Mm-hmm. Wonder why. Smitty, you on air.
Yes.
Man, thank you for holding so long.
Yeah, Cole. No, I want to thank you ever so much. We discussed about this thing in reference to this squeezy case on the Carl Nelson show early this morning. I just heard you and your co-host state that the person was found guilty. And my answer, my question to the two attorneys that you have on your show, how do we determine guiltiness when we don't have fingerprints on the actual gun that they felt was used to do the damage of killing the guy? Are we getting to a world today where we just say, okay, there's no fingerprints on this gun, but I'm still going to hold that person accountable? What is the real way now that it's determined now of a person's being guilty?
Well, I don't know if there was actual fingerprints on the gun, and I don't know all the evidence that they presented in court, but they had videotape. Did they have a videotape of a person holding the gun, whether fingerprints was on the gun or not? Did they have a videotape of the person holding the gun? And you can say, see this gentleman here? This is the same gentleman that is in this clip.
And
that could be visual proof of guilt of someone holding the gun and pulling the trigger.
And Smitty, you know, somebody's prints should have been on the gun, even if it wasn't his. And I look at the fact, I mean, if you look at these shows on TV, a prints can be wiped off a gun.
Exactly.
Okay, so how do we answer that the book bag which the gun was found in, or even whatever it is that they use on their this carrier, inside of that, that from what Wendell Gordon was stating, that inside there, it was a gun in there, but it also was some information pertaining to who was the owner of that book bag, and they also had criminal charges on them, but nobody investigated them as the ownership of the bag that the gun was in, and no fingerprints has been on the gun from the person
have not seen the video.
Yeah, here's
that
what
might have been
well, the video
video
is very grainy,
you
but Wendell Gordon
that.
Has the right video.
We don't know that. He said it was grainy, but the jury might not have found it that grainy.
And that's the important part. The fact that you have these questions raises really an issue that's not addressed, and that is, why under what circumstances should the public not trust the system? Because if you trust that the people who rendered the verdict here was a jury of his peers, were people just like you and me, ordinary people who heard the evidence and made a decision, then we ought to accept that. We can't, because we can take this notion of rejecting the jury too far. Like, you know, everybody thought OJ did it, and I don't care what the jury said. I don't care how many times the glove didn't fit. We know he did it. Well, you don't know he did it. And you got, this system doesn't work if people don't accept the outcome. Now, there are times when you shouldn't accept the outcome. I don't accept the outcome of the jury in the Emmett Till case. I don't accept the outcome of the outcome in the case with Ben Chavis. There are times when we can't accept the outcome and shouldn't accept the outcome because obviously the thing was fixed from the beginning, either by people who came there with predetermined outcomes or predetermined prejudices. But in a case where we accept and trust the people that are in the position to make the decision, we have to trust the decision. We cannot like it. I'm not saying we have to like it, but we can't keep upending the system every time we don't like the decision that the system comes up with.
And one other thing that you need to consider from an attorney's point of view, when you go into the courtroom, the attorneys are not under oath, right? And the job of an attorney is to create doubt, right?
Yeah, right.
And reasonable they don't doubt. Necessarily lie, but they throw in situations that can create doubt whether right. it's true or not. Take, for example, the defense attorney said the guy was drunk. We don't know his blood alcohol level. We don't. But he threw that doubt in there so that people would think, well, maybe he was drunk. But then when they got the test back, we realized he wasn't. He threw in doubt that, oh, maybe he was a racist. He had a tattoo of Proud on his arm. You know, whether he was a racist or not, that might be true. That may be false. But that sense of doubt, you know, that he throws in is what you have to do sometimes, right or wrong, as an attorney to create doubt on behalf of your client. So you can't always listen to what either attorney says, you know, and take it for the truth or take right. it any more of a fact than, you know, creating doubt, which is what I'm supposed to do.
Right.
It may be true. It may be a lie. It may be a smudge of this truth. So you can't take everything at 100% face value.
And one other thing, Smitty, and when I come back to the lines, it's going to be Roger, Larry, Jacob, and D. What kind of baffled me on the defense side or the prosecution side, really, that none of the squeegee boys that was out there when this thing happened
exactly.
testified.
Exactly.
Nobody. None of them.
Right. The defense didn't have any
The defense
witness.
Didn't have, they had none of them to testify or the prosecution. Neither side had any of these young guys that were out there with the shooter, whoever the shooter was, and it's been, you know, found by a jury that it was this young man. Nobody testified that, hey, no, he didn't do it. Or, hey, he did do it. Nobody did that. And that baffles me.
And let this be a lesson to the people you keep in your company. You know, the guy who shot and killed, he's in jail for manslaughter. Now, the other three boys that he was, quote unquote, protecting or trying to defend as part of his friends.
Right.
We haven't heard from them. Were they no. charged with anything?
Yeah.
Did they commit a crime? Are they
it's
back
baffling.
In school,
I'm
out
telling.
On the street, walking around and having
yep.
fun while you're serving time for trying to defend them?
Yep. Final thoughts, Smitty, before I go.
Well, I want to thank both of you for giving us some enlightenment on that there. It's just one of those things, and I guess now it seems as though that if we have a system in place, and even though if your fingerprints is not appearing on a gun or someone thinks that you wiped it off or whatever, you still can be convicted. So that's my take on it right now, I guess.
Okay, Smitty. Thank you. Okay, we're coming to Roger, Larry, Jacob, D. We got a line open, 410-481-1010. And before I come to Roger, let me mention one other thing before it escapes my mind. The mayor appointed a new fire chief, I believe yesterday.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what's baffling me about this, now when they had the press conference announcing this guy, and this is a Caucasian gentleman, he was surrounded by nothing but black fire chiefs and mm-hmm. captains and whatever. The guy that was the interim before this guy got the job was African-American. In fact, I know his mother well. Are you saying that this guy wasn't qualified for the job? Why didn't you make the guy that you put in the job the interim before you did, but all of a sudden you brought him forward? What's this about? Now, just about, here you got in a 65% black city, you now have the head of the police department who ain't really got the job solidified yet is a Caucasian.
A non-city resident.
Non-city resident. In fact, a non-city resident that's supposed to be a city resident even as deputy commissioner.
Right.
And he ain't been.
Right.
Okay. Then you got now a Caucasian head of the fire department knowing the problems of racism that's been within the fire department for many, many years. I hope Leo called back and can really say something about that, because we've been having meetings about that. And there's a bunch of other major positions in the city that the mayor has yet to put the heads of in charge. Just throwing that out there, y'all. Okay, and let's go to Roger, Larry, Jacob D., and Thomas. Roger, you on air. Roger?
Good morning. Good morning, Mr. Good morning, Mr. Douglas. I'm calling you from California. I'm very upset with this case. And first of all, let me attack your attorneys first. I used to have respect for them. First, Attorney Dashiell, you talking about the duty to retreat. You think a 14-year-old boy understands that duty to retreat?
Well, hold on, wait a second. I've never even used the phrase retreat or duty in anything I've said today. So who are you talking about?
Before we get started, I have a question for you. Did you see the video? My question to you is, did you see the video leading up to the shooting?
Wait a second. I'm gonna get to you next.
No. She asked you a question.
Did you see the video?
Okay. I go to YouTube. He wore a mask. How are you gonna identify somebody wearing a mask?
He put the mask.
Didn't it come out that he wore a mask?
Sir. He put the mask on. So they have video of him not wearing a mask before the shooting. He stopped.
Okay, at the time of the shooting, he wore a mask.
But it's a video. Okay. So you're looking at a picture.
Let me finish.
Can you answer my question? Did you see
the video? I will. Okay. Let me answer your question. He was identified.
Did you see the video?
Just answer
yes or no.
Okay,
this conversation is over. Now, let's
get to your point. Now, what are you saying?
What are you saying that I said?
First, with Attorney Dashiell, you said sometimes the aggressor or the victim turns into the aggressor and the vice versa.
I said during the course of the event, at one time that one party was the aggressor and another party was the aggressor at a different time during the course of the same event.
Okay, that's the philosophy of duty to retreat.
That's not the philosophy of duty. I summed it up for you.
When the victim turns into the aggressor, that is the philosophy of duty to retreat. But I don't want to belabor that point.
Right.
But let me get my piece in. First of all, the boy was 14, so he doesn't understand good judgment at 14. Mr. Douglas, you was 14. I was 14. Both of the attorneys were 14, so it shouldn't have been that. And the attorneys on the case, you know, that's why the attorneys is like among the least respected profession, because we don't like attorneys. Lawyers, for all intents and purposes, are liars. The attorney, in his case, wanted to take a plea. This is the plea that the attorney wanted to take at the beginning of the case that was accepted by the attorney Mosby, is that the boy was going to plead guilty to voluntary manslaughter. That's what the attorney wanted in the beginning, and it was rejected by the family. The family didn't want that voluntary manslaughter plea.
So
they wanted first degree.
What's your point?
And my point is, Freddie Gray killers are walking the street. Trayvon Martin killer is walking the street. Why are we so hard on our own people? I feel like this, and then I'm going to get off the phone. If a black man kills a white man, no black person should convict that black man for killing a white man, because it's called payback. Now, if a black man kills another black man, yeah, he should go to jail. He should be convicted. But if any black man kills a white man, nobody on that. That's what happened in the OJ.
I think you're nuts.
First of all, it's called nullification. So I don't know where you're coming from with that one. I don't care who killed who. If you're guilty of it, you should do the time. I don't give a damn what color you are.
Oh, you cursed.
Damn is accepted.
It's in the Bible.
Not only is it in the Bible, the FCC will allow
it. Let's talk to somebody who's not nuts. Let's go on.
Larry, you on air.
Carlton Douglas, I call because you said that you would have gave him second degree murder. And know what? I'm like a celebrity cab driver. I was there for 6 days, and I know what goes on behind the scenes. So I don't have to repeat what Smitty said, because he's correct. Okay? Now, you said autopsy. Autopsy, the man died at 4:30. They didn't look at his, they didn't do the autopsy until after 9 o'clock. So if his blood level was that, it would have been higher if they would have did his autopsy at the time of the death. So that's that.
No, that ain't true. Don't put that
right,
on the air.
I'm not
going
to argue that.
Okay.
I'm not going to.
Now, you talk to a funeral director now, though. Don't even go there with me on that one. Now, go ahead.
Well, we had J. Wendy Gordon explain it to you then. Because he had a
Because J. Wendy Gordon explained it don't mean it's the truth.
He had his medical
examiner. J. Wendy Gordon ain't no medical examiner or a doctor. I'm talking about it as a funeral director who has had cases like this. Okay. Don't tell me about how alcohol levels going to come up in a body.
All right. Okay. So I ain't going to debate with you.
All right.
Now, let's go to the strap. Now,
go to the
fingerprint. The fingerprint, right?
Why you want to retry the case? You don't trust that? You don't trust what the jury did?
There. I know what you wasn't there. I was inside the court.
But the jury made a decision. Do you accept the jury?
Do you accept the decision of the jury?
No. No. Okay. Reasonable doubt.
Then that's it. Bye.
Let's go.
I have a question from a caller who texted in. It says, can you explain how can you say it's a jury of your peers when no one on the jury was his age level? What does it mean when you say a jury of its peers?
Y'all want to explain that? Y'all lawyers.
It means
one line over 410-481-1010.
It means people taken from the same community where they live, reside, or work. It doesn't mean they have to be the same age. It doesn't mean that you cannot be excluded on a basis that's unconstitutional. You can't exclude them because anybody's black or because they're female or whatever. But it doesn't mean they have to be the same age. It doesn't mean they have to go to the same school. It doesn't mean they have to walk the same street. It doesn't mean any of that. It just means people who are a group of people who live from the community who are presumed not to carry any prejudice that would affect their ability to make a decision based on the evidence.
Right. And if you want to break it down in terms of a jury of your peers, it will be impossible to say, okay, we have a 30-year-old woman, so the people on this jury has to be between the ages of 40 and 50.
Right,
they
right,
have to be African-American.
Right,
they have
right,
to be from
right,
Baltimore City.
Right, right.
I mean, if you look at that, quote-unquote, what the definition of a peer is.
Okay. Coming to Jacob, we're coming to Jacob D., Thomas, and Ali. And in one line, 410-481-1010, 410-481-1010. Jacob, you're on air.
How you doing?
Fine.
Two calls ago, the guy said that any white person that kills a black person, we shouldn't convict them. I guess I don't know what kind of water they're drinking in California. I can't go to California because he's insane.
He burning up out there. That's what it is.
He must be. He must have burned his brain cells up. Attorney Dashiell said during the Glendenning era in Hagerstown, they had some great programs out there in those prisons.
Right.
I will say this. They very well probably did.
They still do, by the way. They still do.
That's great. But at Patuxent Institution, they have the best programs in the state of Maryland. They always have. In fact, they have so many good programs there. It's the only prison in the state of Maryland there's a waiting list to go in. Only prison.
And it's the only one with an indefinite period of incarceration.
Yeah. Yes, but they've stopped that now. That's no longer in existence.
Yeah.
Yes, but that's the only prison. In fact, I think they should have two of them because it's the only prison that you have to get on a waiting list to go to.
Well, no, you got to commit a crime first.
Of course, that's. But you got to get on a waiting list. Other than that, you're gonna go to these other places.
All right.
Because they're very well staffed. And, I think
you're right. You're right. Patuxent is of the penal institutions in this state, and I've been to Patuxent many times. It is one of the most advanced that we have.
Hey, Jacob, before you go, it just seems to me that not only the state of Maryland, but many other states have taken, but have become more pro-punishment than rehabilitation.
That's how the system is built. It was only built really to capture slaves in the first place.
Yeah.
So they say.
Right.
I don't know.
Thank you. Thank you, Jacob. Appreciate you, man. Let's go to D. D, you're on air.
Good morning. Good morning. I think that you called a couple calls ago. It just drives me nuts when I hear people say that. I think we are so too busy being black, too busy being white. We have forgotten that we're all human. And the fact that you think that just because he's black and he kills a white, it just bothers me. I think Miss Tehma stole my thunder when I wanted to say regarding lawyers. Lawyers' job is to distort the evidence. I mean,
to create.
That's a charge word.
Not the evidence, but the narrative.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, pretty much to create doubt, to create some to make the jury believe that what they're seeing or what the police have discovered is not really
That's right. You know? Who are you going to believe, me or your lying eyes? Go ahead.
Exactly. I just think that, you know, we have so many problems in the black community. You know, you got black people killing black people. You know, so you know, who cares what color the person is that dies? Somebody's dead and somebody did it.
Yep.
That's the whole.
Yep.
Thank you guys for taking my call.
Appreciate you, Dean. Thomas, you on it? Thomas, you on air.
Carlton Douglas, my main man, who married above himself, so did I. The attorney, Bob Robert Dashiell, you married above yourself, young fella. And Miss Tehma Smith Wilson, Attorney of the Year. How you guys doing?
Fine.
Thank you.
Hey, Carlton, let me ask this one question. If I understand what everybody's saying about the evidence and whatever, okay? But if the prosecution had a case, had evidence of first-degree murder and second-degree murder, but they came back with manslaughter, what happened to all of the evidence?
Well, first of all, the prosecution didn't do that. That's what the jury came back with.
Right.
The jury came back with manslaughter. The prosecution didn't...
as a compromise.
Yeah.
But that's what I'm saying. Wasn't the prosecution going for first and second degree murder?
Yes.
Yeah,
Then the jury rejected it.
And the jury rejected it.
Right, but I think all three of them were options, right?
Yes.
All three of them were options.
That's
so
why they
couldn't agree on first
degree. Right.
First degree
or the second degree.
Right.
In order to avoid a jury or a mistrial, they agreed on the third.
Yeah.
Right.
Now, Ms. Wilson and Mr. Bob, you guys are licensed attorney. And I'm going to take your word for what the next question I'm about to ask you guys. If you got someone who's a federal prosecutor or whatever they may be, the capacity they'll be in, involved in a totally separate case that they're not on record as, okay, can they be charged or disbarred for that?
I don't understand the question.
If you got, let's just put it out there. Saruvin Naraja, okay? Was he the prosecution's spokesperson on this, or was he? I know he said he was.
He did not represent a party in the case at all.
Yeah,
he was kind of like a spokesperson. Yeah,
we went over this before, Thomas. He spoke for the family.
He's a spokesperson for the family who happens to be an attorney.
Yeah, let's go to Allie. Allie, you on the line?
Hey, what's up, fellas? How y'all doing today?
Fine.
Good. Tehma, how many times did you ask that one man, did he see the film and did he see the video? You must have asked him 15 times. He never answered you.
Yes, he did. He finally said no.
He finally said no.
Yeah. Well, that's what I'm trying to say.
It was only seven times. Go ahead.
But Tehma asked him 15 times.
No, it was only seven. Go ahead.
Yeah, okay. Well, I'm just exactly. And Bob, why do people always putting things in your mouth, things that you didn't say? Are they listening to what you're saying?
Well, I learned a long time ago. I'm responsible for what I say. I'm not responsible for what you hear.
Exactly. And Carlton, let me answer your question about when you said that, why didn't they bring some of the squeegees in the court to testify, right?
Right.
Okay. Let me answer the question for you. I know one of the ladies whose son was out there squeegeeing, and she told me that detectives had visited her house and wanted to know who, because that same guy has been talked to by the police before about some other disturbance that he had on that corner. So they knew who he was. So they went to him, and she told me that they asked her son, "Do you know who was the shooter involved?" He said her son told the detective who was involved. So they didn't want her. That's why you don't have a murder charge or the second degree murder charge. But if they would have put that boy on stand, that would have convicted the shooter, then he would have got a murder or second-degree murder charge. So the defense, the prosecution really did the defense a favor. and, and Warren Brown and Wendell Gordon know all this information during discovery. That's why you didn't see any discreet kids on stand. Because if I was a lawyer and you had no fingerprints, you don't know the shooter, I think I would have been hunting for one of them discreet kids to put on that stand to verify all of that.
Okay. All right, now listen, we got 12 minutes here. I'm trying to get everybody in. So make your point as quickly as possible. Tehma?
I have a comment from Mr. Johnson on the text line.
Mm-hmm.
As far as the fire department is concerned, all of the graduating classes at the fire academy in the history of the department, there's never been a majority class that was minority black candidates or candidates. It says, in this majority black city, so the mayor's decision to pick a white chief is in line with him picking mostly white people in his administration. So what do you think, that the black people in this area aren't qualified to hold those higher offices?
That's what I'm saying. That's exactly why I brought it up.
Well, there have been two black fire chiefs that I can recall. Ford, the one who resigned supposedly because of the fact that the firefighters got killed, and Williams.
Yeah. Montel's daddy.
Montel's father.
Yeah.
And then my question was, why would that be a reason to resign? You know, as a fire chiefs or firemen, tragic situations like this happen, right? And in my opinion, no one is at fault from the police, from the fire department, right? So that shouldn't be a reason for him to have to quote unquote resign or give up his position.
I understand that were other, you're right. And that wasn't the real reason.
Right.
Yeah. Leo, quickly.
Yes. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I simply want to say that this is Leo. I have consulted with Bill Jones, the president of the Black Firefighters group called Vulcan Blazers of Baltimore City Incorporated. And he agrees with me, and they've had a 50-year track record, that racism is alive and well in the Baltimore City Fire Department, and that he may, in fact, convene a press conference on or before the 21st of August to speak and delineate, to share the information and the evidence available that the discrimination is continuing to flourish, and that, in fact, in my opinion, the fire department should be under a consent decree.
Why did the mayor appoint the person that he appointed, the white person? Assuming the mayor knows what you know, and assuming he's been told what you were told, why would he appoint the person that he appointed?
The mayor is running for re-election, and he'll do anything that he deems necessary in a selfish vein to represent his interests and get re-elected.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
All right. We're going to, Coach, quickly as you can, because I got a full board. Coach?
Just real quick, man. Thank you. It's refreshing to hear on these airways, which was so hollowed with great, great talk show people, but it's so refreshing to hear a balanced, fact-based show. And you have people who are calling in who's not read anything, and all they've heard is one side. They're quoting J. Wendell Gordon. J. Wendell's job as a defense attorney is to create doubt. Okay? And you have people calling in saying preposterous, ridiculous, idiotic stuff about, well, you know, I would never convict a black person if they committed a heinous crime against someone white. Have some of us lowered the bar that low?
Yeah.
Our generation, Bob and Carlton and your dad's generation, Tehma, we had higher standards. You know what? Our standards were so high that we felt that we were above white people, that white people would do certain things that we wouldn't. Yeah. Have some of you out there lowered the bar. Well, hey, team, keep on raising the bar, and don't just let people call in and say anything they want without checking them with facts. Thank you for doing it. I'm out.
Thank you, Coach. Let's go to Larry, Andre, Jim, and the last caller for the day going to be Mike. Now get your point in as quickly as possible because I don't have that much time. Trying to get you in. Larry, quickly.
Carlton, now this is me you hung up on. I didn't know you was going to hang up on me because I wasn't done. But if that's how you do me, that's the way you
that's the way the ball lands.
Got to go. Got to go. Yeah, once you know, your point was true. Let's go. Andre, you're on air.
Hey, thank you, Carlton. Quickly, I agree with Coach and everybody else. Why are we making excuses for negative behavior in our black community? These 14-year-olds are committing heinous crimes, and we want to call them babies. But then when they kill your family member, then you want to throw the book. I'm tired of these blacks making excuses for negative behavior in our community. And I appreciate y'all not doing that. Thank you so much.
You're welcome. Jim, you're on air.
Yeah, what I thought would had to be done is they should have charged them with murder so that they could hold that against them and then come back in 5 years after he'd him in a cell and turned into a mushroom and then said, where'd you get the gun? Because they are really the people that killed Mr. White Man. It's the people who gave that young man the gun. And that's the problem. Because guns don't kill people. It's people. And his mother, his father knew he had a gun. They should be charged. Not this young man, but there should be justice in the form of them going to jail.
Well, let me ask, you say the parents knew. How you know they knew?
They had their child running out here in the streets. The mayor been talking about how these young kids got guns.
But it doesn't mean that the parents knew. Now,
to go through their clothes.
Now, I would agree with you if the parents knew, because we just had a case a couple weeks ago of a young man that killed the 9-year-old that killed, I think she was 14 or 15-year-old.
And the grandmother
was responsible for the gun. Now the grandma get ready to do 6 years. I would agree with you if the parents knew this boy had the gun or they had anything to do with him having the gun, that they should do some time. But if they did
they
not
need to make a law for them to take polygraph tests, because I would like to see them, both the mother and the father, take a polygraph test. And this mother from the cops that shot this young man, I would like to see her take a polygraph test, because I'm pretty sure she knew her son had a gun, the way she be talking. And I would love to see that.
Well, to agree and disagree with you, I'm not sure if they knew that they had a gun, but we do not know that the parents allowed their child to squeegee since he was 12.
Yeah. Yeah.
Which is unfortunate.
I'm just not going to agree with the fact that the parents knew that he had a gun. Period. Mike, you're the last caller for today.
Hey, thank you, guys. It's Mike Johnson. Thanks for having a really good show. I just want to remind everybody that the top 12 departments, which were headed by black folks, which is BDC, Police Department, Fire Department, Housing Department, Health Department, Public Works, Planning, Social Service, Parking Authority, Library, Convention Center, and Finance, have now all been replaced by white department heads. And I appreciate you giving me this opportunity.
Yeah, and that's what we talked about, Mike. This guy, I don't know what it is with this guy, but for some reason, and then the black folk that he had been putting in certain position, hierarchy position, they leaving. They getting out of Dodge.
Well, I mean, everybody can smell the water. The point is that it took so long, and you got everybody on this station know, from the time that Kirk Smoke got in to at least get African Americans an opportunity to run these departments. In less than three years, we've replaced 12 departments with 12 white folks. And it's election year. You got to let the white folks figure out, hey, I'm one of you.
Yep.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you, Mike. Listen, have you guys
heard?
Well,
that's not entirely true, by the way, but go ahead.
Yeah. Have you guys heard, because I had somebody call my show the other day, and I haven't seen it in print yet. Have you guys heard that the President Biden has given Martin O'Malley the job of being the head of the Social Security Administration?
I read that somewhere, yes.
It is? Yeah, so it is true.
So what do y'all
think about that? Because the caller text me wanting to know your thoughts on what you think about O'Malley taking that position.
You really don't want me to tell you what I think about it. But go ahead. Go ahead, Bob. What's your opinion?
I could care less.
Okay. All right. What about you, Tehma?
I don't know enough.
I don't either,
when
really.
O'Malley was mayor, I wasn't currently residing.
I'm just trying to figure out why he even gave him a job, period, but especially one that is the head of Social Security, because I don't know if he's that qualified. I am sure that there are some individuals in that department that have come all the way up that realm of that department that could adequately and professionally do a better job than Martin O'Malley. First of all, he wasn't that good a mayor to me. Why they ever elevated him from mayor to governor really boggles my mind. And he definitely, in my opinion, was not the overwhelming great Democratic governor.
Well, it's not who you, what you know is who you know.
That is true. All right, closing remarks.
Thank you for joining us once again this Friday. It was a pleasure to have you listening in, calling in, and texting in. I enjoyed the conversation, and I look forward to being back with you again soon.
Be sure to listen in to our upcoming programs. We're going to have the director of the mayor's new office of small and minority business advocacy, Chris Lundy, on. And on August 25th, we're going to have as our special call-in guest the governor's appointment secretary, Ms. Tisha Edwards, is going to be our special guest.
Would like to talk to her.
On August 25th, Robert Dashiell, procurement attorney, general fixer, if you will, 410-547-8820.
And Tehma, your number?
667-334-7242, 667-334-7242.
And this has been also Carlton C. Douglas of the Carlton C. Douglas Funeral Services. If you need our assistance, telephone number is 410-669-1738, 410-669-1738. And as always, tell you, take your head with your ear, put it to the ground, listen to the grass grow. See ya. Don't want to be ya. Bye. Next week, we'll be back.
Can love and affection to keep them strong, moving in the right direction, living just enough for the city.
The new 1010 WOLB.